All right, so Hare Krishna, and my pranams to all the Avatari Desh devotees. Please accept my humble obeisances. Vancha Kalpataru Bhayascha Kripa Sindhu Vevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Anantakoti Vaishnavrindaki Jai Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai His Holiness Jayapataka Swami Guru Maharaj Ki Jai Vartaman Iskon Guru Vrindaki Jai. So thank you so much for having me again on this hopefully concluding session of Gopi Geet. So yesterday, Shri Radha Damodar Bhagwan ki jai, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani ki jai, Sitaram Lakshman Hanuman ki jai, Lakshmi Narsingadev Bhagwan ki jai, Shri Gaunithai ki jai, Giriraj Govardhan ki jai, Tulsi Maharani ki jai, and Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna. So yesterday, we had stopped at a very important text in the Gopi Geet, that is text number 9. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Leela chapter 14, you can see this how yesterday I was explaining that Pratap Rudra Maharaj had recited Gopi Geet, and especially when he was reciting this particular verse, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu became so happy and he hugged Pratap Rudra Maharaj. So we stopped yesterday at this verse. Now for those who have joined today for the first session, we give a little recap for 5 minutes and then we'll come to the today's text. So we are talking last 2 weeks about this very beautiful scene happening in Vrindavan, where Krishna has left the gopis in the middle of the Ras Leela, and the gopis are crying in separation of Krishna. And they are singing beautiful verses, and in text 1, 2, 3, they talk about Krishna's beauty and they request Krishna that please come back, because we are your maid servants, we are your maid servants, we are your shulka dasika, and don't play these games with us, and you are killing us by not being present before us because we are very attached to you, and we are remembering your sweet words, your sweet talks, your loving glances, and you were so close to us just a couple of minutes ago, and now suddenly you disappear. So Krishna, please come back. And then they talk about, you know, in this Gopi Geet, the gopis also give us a glimpse of the profound knowledge that the gopis are having. It's not that the gopis are simply emotionally attached to Krishna, but they know that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So they say, Nakhalu Gopika, we know that you're not just the son of Yashoda and Nanda, but yes, you are Antaryami, you are, you know, in everybody's heart in form of Paramatma. And then the gopis went on to explain that how Krishna's lotus feet are so powerful, and whoever surrenders to it are free from any kind of bhaya. And then we discussed about the gopis telling Krishna that we are able to hold our life just because we are hearing your katha. This is where we stopped yesterday. Tava katha amritam. So the gopis were telling Krishna that your katha is like a nectar, like a amrita. And just because we are hearing that katha, somehow we are able to keep our lives together. And then the gopis went on to explain that Shravana Mangalam, how if somebody is hearing your katha, everything in their life will become auspicious, will become Mangalam. And then in the last line, the gopis say, who are doing this? The devotees who are telling your katha, they are having very magnificent heart. They are really having very generous heart. Otherwise, who in this world will give somebody so big charity? See, in this world there are many kinds of charity. Sometimes we give annadanam, sometimes we give vastradanam, sometimes we give kanyadanam. There are different benefits of different kind of charity. But the gopis say this is the highest charity somebody can give, when somebody is giving Krishna katha. So gopis say that we can never ever repay the debt of those who are giving Krishna katha. So then yesterday we very fondly remembered how our dear Srila Prabhupada has given this charity of Krishna katha to all the jivas all around the world. Otherwise everybody in this material world are suffering, but the only thing that is giving some relief is Krishna katha. So now we will go to our today's sloka. प्रहसितं प्रिया प्रेम वीक्षणं विहरणं च ते ध्यानमंगलं रहसि संविदो या हृदि स्पृशा कुहकनो मना शोभयन्ति ही. सो नाउ when the gopis are talking about tava kathamritam, probably Krishna is asking the gopis, so who is asking you to speak my katha? Did I tell you that you speak my katha? Why are you speaking my katha? So the gopis are answering Krishna, look, it's not that you are asking us to speak katha, but it's just that we can't live without speaking your katha, because we are constantly reminded of you. Our tongues are not under our control. They keep talking about you. Our mind is not under our control. It keeps thinking about you. Our eyes are not under our control. It's just asking for you. Our eyes want to see you. This is what the gopis are clarifying. See, those who are the pure devotees of the Lord, naturally they are attracted to speak about Lord, hear about Lord, see the Lord, serve the Lord. They don't have to make any conscious effort. We see in the Chaitanya Leela, this very beautiful story comes about Gopal Guru. How a small 5-year-old boy, when he's walking around, he sees somebody going for the nature's call. In those days, there were no restrooms. So somebody is passing a stool in the open wilderness. But the person who was passing the stool is a very good devotee of Krishna. And his tongue is so used to chanting about Krishna that even when he's passing stool, his tongue keeps wagging, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. And he feels, this is not correct. I'm passing stool. How can I chant Krishna's name here? So with one hand he is holding his tongue tightly that I'll not allow you to chant Krishna's name. And this small boy Gopal, he's just walking from there, and when he sees this scene, he tells that devotee, hey, why are you doing this? Allow your tongue to chant. And then the devotee replies, but I'm not in a, you know, socha, I'm not in a proper place, you know, it's I'm just passing stool. So then this small boy Gopal says, oh, so you are thinking that because this place is not clean, you can't chant Krishna's name? Is it what you are thinking? But what is the guarantee that at this moment when you are passing a stool and urine, you won't give up your body? And in case if you give up your body at this very moment without chanting Krishna's name, what will happen to you? What will be your destination? So we are supposed to chant Krishna's name all the time, irrespective of where and what situation, in which place we are. So then when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu hears this, he becomes so happy. He instantly says that this Gopal is not Gopal, he's Gopal Guru. Though he's such a small boy, he gave such a beautiful instruction. So then fondly everybody started calling him Gopal Guru. So same situation is with the gopis. They're saying, we're just remembering you again and again. We're not able to control ourselves. So here in the first line they say, Prahasitam Priya Prema Vikshanim. Hasitam means smile. Prahasitam means beautiful smile. So gopis are saying, Prahasitam, your smile is so beautiful. And then the gopis say, Prema Vikshanam, not only is your smile beautiful, even your glance is so beautiful. See, in this world also, many people may be having a beautiful smile, but their smile may not be genuine. Why do I say that? Because you see, in this world you ask anybody, how are you? They'll say, ah, yeah, I'm fine, I'm very fine. But what are you fine? You are suffering with adidevik, adhyatmik, adibhautik, so much tapa. You are away from Krishna. You have got this material body. You have to go back to your home. So what are you happy about? So everybody has this a false smile, and sometimes rather they have a plastic smile. It may not even genuinely mean anything, or they may not even be genuinely happy, but they just put up a smile. But Krishna's smile is really beautiful because he is really happy. He's not trying to act to look smart, or he's not trying to act to look happy. He's Sachidananda Vigraha, Ananda Ghana Bhagwan. So he's really happy. So that smile is original smile. So Krishna's smile is Prahasitam, very beautiful smile. And then the gopis say, prema vikshanam. Iksha, your glance is also, it's not simply glance. That glance is made up of safety, security. It gives shelter to the devotees. Your glance is so beautiful. See, like, in the normal day-to-day life also, sometimes, you know, when the parents, they take children to the park for playing, you know, you'll observe the children, they're so smart. While they're playing, in between, every 10, 15, 20 minutes, they will look back, whether the mother is looking at them or not, or whether the father is there or not. And then the mother or the father, they give a very reassuring glance. They may not say anything, but the way they will look is like, yes, I'm here, don't worry, you can play. And then the moment the mother gives that reassuring glance to the child becomes so confident, you know. But imagine if the mother doesn't give that glance to the child, and let's say the mother went to buy some water bottle or something, or popcorn or ice cream, and the child cannot see the mother, immediately he will lose all his confidence. He'll become so anxious. He will lose all his concentration on the play because he's not able to see the mother. So similarly, the Lord's glance on his devotees, Krishna's glance on his devotees, is so reassuring. The way he gives glance, the devotees feel so secure, so safe, nothing to worry. Lord is there. He'll take care of me. So here the gopis are saying, Prahasitam, your smile is beautiful. Your glance is merciful. Then the gopis say, not only his smile is beautiful, but his smile also has the power to relieve us from all kinds of pain. The moment Krishna smiles, see, even in our lives, sometimes, you know, when you're worried, you just go and stand in front of your deities. And when you see that beautiful smile on the face of your deities, immediately you feel so relaxed, right? So the gopis are saying that your smile has that power. Even if somebody is in anxiety, the moment they see your smile, all tension goes away. They feel really happy and safe and secure. And then in the next line, the gopi says, Viharanam cha te dhyana mangalam. Lord, it's not only your smile, it's not only your glance, even your walking, viharanam, that is so beautiful. Like Vallabhacharya says, that the Lord's walking, you know, Vallabhacharya explains in the sloka, he says, Vachanam madhuram charitam madhuram valitam madhuram vasanam madhuram chalitam madhuram bhramitam madhuram madhuradipate rakhilam madhuram. His vachanam, his words are madhuram. His charitam, his character is madhuram. His valitam, vasanam, his clothes, his chalitam, his walking, his bramitam, his wandering, everything is sweet of the emperor of sweetness. So here the gopis are saying, your viharanam, we are reminded the way you walk, Krishna, so beautiful. Krishna has this very unique style of walking. When Krishna walks, you know, with his one hand, he puts on the shoulder of his friends. And on the other hand, he will have a lotus in his hand. And he will be twirling the lotus, you know, round and round. And then with his eyes, he will be giving sidelong glances to the gopis. And very beautiful smile, he'll be walking. So the gopis are reminded of that. So they're saying, your viharanam is also so beautiful. And then they say something. They say, if somebody is reminded of your beautiful smile, your beautiful glance, your beautiful walking, then you know what happens when they remember this? Dhyana, when they meditate on this, dhyana mangalam, everything will be mangalam in their life. But here, the gopis are taunting Krishna. They're saying that it may be mangalam for your devotees, but at present for us, it is that those memories of yours are burning us all the more. It is something like, you know, when you are having a fire sacrifice, what happens when you put a little bit more ghee in the fire, or if you put a little bit more wood in the fire? The fire will become more stronger, it will become more powerful, it will become more brighter. So the gopis are saying, this is what is happening with us. The more we remember your talk, the more we remember your eyes, the more we remember your smile, the more we remember the way you walk, it's making us, it's making our hearts suffer all the more. And then the gopis say, Rahasi Samvido. Oh, not only that, we are also remembering the Rahasi Samvido. You know, all those conversations that you had with us in solitary places, all those talks that you had with us, we are again and again remembering those talks of yours. And then he says, Ya Hridi Sprisha. And they are touching our heart, they are killing us. Your talks we are remembering again and again. Those memories are coming back again and again. And then the final line, the gopis say, Kuhaka no mana shobhayantihi. They start this ninda stuti. They call Krishna Kuhaka, a cheater. You are a cheater. Why are you a cheater? Because you called us here and now you left us. You stole our hearts. You are a cheater. See, this is how the gopis can speak to Krishna, because they have such intimate relation with Krishna. Those devotees who have a very sweet relationship with Krishna, they even swear words on Krishna, they criticize him, they fight with him. Like we see in this a very beautiful story of, in a Jagannath Leela, how... when Ramanujacharya comes to Jagannath Puri and he requests the king that I want to change the Seva Puja of Jagannath because it's not according to the Pancharatrika system. And so the king agrees, all right, so kindly bring your staff and change the Seva Puja. So Ramanujacharya says, all right, tomorrow morning I'll be here with my staff and my pujaris and I will change the complete system. So they're all ready now. Now these pujaris, who have been worshipping Jagannath for all these years, they get very upset. We have been worshipping Jagannath as our own. And now Ramanujacharya is going to come tomorrow and he will take away our service from us. So what these pujaris do, they go inside the altar, the Garbhagudi, and they go and fight with Jagannath. And in the Oriya language, they very lovingly tell Jagannath, Ore Kalia, hey black one, looks like you really don't have heart. We served you for so many years and now you, as soon as a new person comes to take your service, you are ready to give us up and you are ready to take his service. Oh my God, why did we even give our heart to you? We should have known it long back that you are a heartless person. Because we remember even Yashoda Mata, she served you so nicely, she brought you up so nicely. But just because you wanted to see Mathura, big city, and you wanted to give up a village and live in a city, you just left your mother and father and you walked away. So somebody who can even do that to his own parents, why were we even expecting that you won't do that with us? Oh, you are a hard-hearted person. So we all know this story, how then Jagannath is laughing, and then next day what Jagannath does, in the middle of the night, he just transfers Ramanujacharya with his bed from Puri to Vishakhapatnam, to a place here called Sri Kurmam. And when Ramanujacharya gets up in the morning, he sees he's not in Puri, he's somewhere else. And here all the king and all the entourage, they are waiting for Ramanujacharya to come inside the temple and take up the Seva Puja. And they're all waiting and waiting, and Ramanujacharya doesn't turn up. So then they said, leave it, and the Pandas continue their service. So the Pandas are doing Ninda Stuti, right? We also see how the... In Bhagavatam, there's another chapter where the Geet, the Brahmar Geet, the bumblebee conversation, where the gopis have this very sweet conversation with the bumblebee when Uddhava comes to Vrindavan to counsel the gopis, that don't cry so much for Krishna. At that time, the gopis are having conversation with bumblebee. So one gopi tells the bumblebee, Purnamasi told us that Krishna, in his previous birth, he came as Rama. And when he came as Rama, he was so cruel, just like a hunter behind the tree. he put an arrow on Vali and he killed the poor guy without any reason, just because he was in love with some lady. So some lady means Sita Devi. Just because he was in love with some lady and just because he wanted to get her and he wanted the help of Sugriva, he killed the poor Vali. So heartless he is. Then the other gopi says, "Are, not only that, you know what I have heard? Puranmasi told us that in his previous life, he came as a Brahmana in form of Vamana. And you know what he did? He betrayed Bali Maharaj. Bali gave so much charity and he's so heartless. He sent Bali to Patal Loka. He took away everything from Bali." So they are telling all this to the bumblebee, how cruel Krishna is. So what can we expect from a cruel Krishna? And now see what he did? He left us and he went off to Mathura. So Krishna is like that only. That's what the gopis are saying. So here the gopis are telling Krishna, "Kuhaka, hey, you are a cheater." You see, even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in his Sikshashtakam, he used a very sweet word for Krishna. Why he does that? Because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we all know, is a combined Rupa of Radha and Krishna. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in the mood of Radha Rani, he sings this last verse, you know, of Sikshashtakam, where he says, "Aslisyava padaratam pinastuma madarshanam marmahatam karotuva yatha tatha vavidhati lampato matprana nathastu sa eva napara." So here, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying that, "Krishna, you are a lampat." Lampat means, lampat is usually a word used for those who are womanizers, those who are back of ladies. So here, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying, "Krishna, you are a lampat. As soon as you will see some girl, you will start walking behind. You will not even understand, here is somebody who is loving you, but the moment somebody else gives you love, you will go away, leaving this person. This is how you are, Krishna. But anyway, no matter how you are, I will not leave you. Even if you kick me, you leave me, whatever way you treat me, but we are not going to leave you. Your devotees, they will not leave you." So here, you see, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also says Krishna is a lampat, you know. He very easily gets attracted if somebody calls him with love, and he may leave the other person and walk away. See, if you have been to this temple in Vrindavan, very famous temple, it's called Banke Bihari Temple. You know, in Banke Bihari Temple, it once so happened that the curtain opened and everybody is getting darshan of the Lord. Now, there was one particular devotee who was seeing at Banke Bihari with so much love and affection. And after his prayers are over, he just going away back home. Now, he was praying so beautifully that the moment he's going away, Banke Bihari also starts walking behind him. He also wants to go away with him. So the pujaris, they see suddenly the Lord is walking behind that devotee. And the pujaris call him, "Hey Bihari, where are you going?" No, he's worshipping me with so much love and affection, so I'm going behind him. And the pujaris again take him back and put him in the altar. "You cannot go like that. You are a main vigraha of our temple. You have to stay here only." And from that time onwards, the pujaris decide that, you know, our Lord is so innocent. If anybody worship him with love and affection, he will just go away with him. So from that time onwards, what they started doing is, every 5 minutes they close the curtain so that no devotee will develop that intimate relation with Banke Bihari. So every 5-10 minutes they will close the curtain so that Lord doesn't develop that attachment to any devotee and he doesn't go away with them. So Krishna is like that. If somebody is looking at him with love and affection, and then he is immediately ready to go. So the gopis are saying to Krishna, "Kuhaka, you are a cheater. Somebody will show you more affection, you leave us and you'll go there, you know. You are a cheater." So he says, "Kuhaka no mana shobhayanti hi." Oh Krishna, just by remembering all those, our minds are agitated. Please come back. We want to see you again. Please come back. We'll go to the next sloka. Chala siyad vraja charayar pashum nalina sundaram nathate padam शिला त्रिनान कुरै सिद्धति तिना कलीलतम मना कांत गच्छति. सो हियर दिस श्लोका गोपीज आर सेइंग दैट डियर मास्टर ओ डियर लवर कृष्णा, see, when you leave this cowherd village and when you go to the forest, there's a little problem here. In this forest, there are lots of thorns, and we are worried that these thorns may prick you. So, you know, in the daytime, when you take the cows for grazing, we are worried at that time, but that worry is a little less troublesome because we know that you are with your cowherd friends, we know it's daytime, you can look down, you know, if there are any thorns, you can be careful. But now it is night time, and in the night time you are trying to hide from us, and you are trying to hide in this bush and that bush, trying to give us trouble. But in this process you may end up hurting yourself, some thorn may prick you, and in the dark dense forest you can't even see those thorns, they are not even visible. So that is what is our worry, Krishna. So that is why just come back, because we have to take care of you. You know, some thorn may prick you. Please come back. We are very much worried because your feet are very soft feet, and in this forest the grass is very rough. You know, in the forest this durva grass, they're very sharp. So they may prick you. So, oh Krishna, just come back, come back. We are very much worried that you may hurt yourself. So here he says, please come back, Krishna. And here they use this word for Krishna, Kanta. Kanta means a lover. So they say, Krishna, what is a lover supposed to do? A lover supposed to love the beloved. A lover supposed to give happiness. But on the contrary, here you are giving us so much suffering. And the problem with you is, Krishna, when we see you also, there is suffering. Why? Because we are thinking, I don't know how long we'll get time with you. Maybe after some time you will just leave. Oh, the time is running short. So in your sayog, when we meet you, there is a tension, constant tension that you will go away. And if you go away, there is more tension because now we don't know when you will come back. So your sayog or your viyog, that means meeting you or separation, both is giving trouble. Because meeting you also is a trouble, because we are thinking you will just go away, don't know how long we'll get time with you. And when you leave, anyway, it's a trouble because we are not able to see you. So Krishna, you know what? You're only giving us trouble. You're only giving us suffering. Just thinking about you is a suffering, seeing you is again suffering, and then again if you go away from your sight, is from our sight, is also suffering. So we just suffering, Krishna, please come back. That's what the gopis are saying. And here the gopis, they use this word pashu. You know why? Instead of saying a cow, a dhenu or gomata, they just say pashu, because they're trying to drive home a point that these cows are, after all, pashu. They're just animals. So they're not going to be careful that, oh, Krishna is running behind us, so let's not climb the hill, or let's not get inside this kunja, this has lot of thorns. They're pashu. There is no guarantee. They may just go up and down on some rough road, or they may just go inside some bushes. They will just go about anywhere, and you simply follow them because you love the cows, and then you will end up hurting yourself. So that is what we are worried. So we were worried then also when you used to go with the cows for grazing, and we are worried now also because we are worried for your lotus feet. You may hurt yourself. So Krishna, please come back. Please come back. Now we'll go to the next sloka. दीना परीक्षये नीलकुंटले वनरुहाननाम बेब्रदावृतम घनरजाश्वलम दर्शयान्मुहुर् मनसिनास्मराम वीरयाचसि. सो हियर द गोपीज आर सेइंग दीना परीक्षये, कृष्णा, वी वेट फॉर यू एट द एंड ऑफ द डे. when you are going to come and when we'll be able to see your beautiful face. See what happens in Vrindavan. When Krishna leaves in the morning with the cows, the gopis, they go for a bidding farewell, you know, saying goodbye to Krishna. So they're all standing, somebody is standing in the balcony, somebody is standing, you know, just right the place from where Krishna will enter the forest. And they're all very lovingly looking at Krishna. And they're all waiting, you know, and Krishna starts moving with his cows. So they can just see Krishna from the back. But still they don't turn their heads and go back home. They keep standing there till the end, when finally Krishna is no more visible. They can't see Krishna anymore. They can't see Krishna's cows. And not only that, they wait till the moment when they can't even see that dust. You know what happens when there are, see, Krishna's father had 9 lakh cows. So you imagine when he's going with this 9 lakh cows, the cows may be stamping on the dust, right? And then the dust goes up in the air. So here, what the gopis wait, that after the dust that has gone up in the sky, that also will get settled down after some time, right? When they have gone far off. So the gopis, they wait till the dust gets settled. And then, when they turn themselves to go back home, now all the way from that place to their house, they will keep criticizing the sun. Why are you so lazy? Why do you take so much time? Don't you have anything to do? Simply standing and staring at us? Why can't you move a little bit quicker so that the day ends and the moon comes, and so that our Krishna, our moon-like Krishna, will come back with the cows and we can see his beautiful face again. So the gopis, whole day they are fighting with the sun. Go quickly, walk quickly, move quickly. Just make place for the moon. So here the gopis are saying, whole day we wait for you, dina parikshaye. We wait that when will you come back and when will we see your beautiful face. But you know, Krishna, what happens when you actually come back? There's more problem. What is that problem? They're saying, dina parikshaye neelakuntaler. When you come back, your face is completely full of dust because whole day you have been out in the forest. Oh, that is all right, even if it is full of dust. But another problem is, neelakuntaler, your thick curly hairs will come on your face. So we cannot even see your face clearly. That is one problem we face. And then, even though your face is full of dust and even though your thick hairs are clouding your face, but whatever that we are able to see little of you, it's so beautiful. And you know how you look at the time? You look like a wild lotus flower. Because you see, sometimes you see those trees and leaves which are in the forest, sometimes they're just covered with so much dust. So you look like a lotus flower which is covered with dust. So he says, vana ruhana nam bibridavritam. You know, you look so beautiful like a lotus. Now here we see Krishna is so proud of carrying the dust of Vrindavan. Everything connected to Krishna is so beautiful. Even the dust of Vrindavan is so beautiful. And as devotees, devotees are attached to everything that is connected to Krishna. So the gopis are even attached to the dust of Vrindavan because it is connected to Krishna. See, like even as devotees, when we go to Vrindavan, what we do? We just roll ourselves in Raman Reti and we just put all the dust on our bodies because that dust is connected to Krishna. Everything that is connected to Krishna is very, very auspicious, you know. Now, there is beach in Vizag and there's lots of dust on the and lots of sand on the beach, but nobody will take that sand and put on the head. But when we go to Vrindavan, we just take that sand and we'll take that dust and we'll even bring it back home and we'll keep it in our house and we'll put it on our head every single day because it's connected to Krishna. And even the dust of Vrindavan is so powerful. See, it says that if somebody wants to go to Vrindavan, you can't buy a ticket to go to Vrindavan. It's not possible. Nobody can buy a ticket, and go to Vrindavan. You really need a sanction of so many people just to go to Vrindavan. So out of the sanction of so many people, you need the sanction of Vrinda Devi. she has to sanction. You need the sanction of Giriraj Govardhan. You need the sanction of Gomata. You need the sanction of Vishakha Devi. You need the sanction of Radha Rani. So like that, so many people have to, you know, just like in the government, sometimes you have to pass a paper. So many tables, you know, in the office, it will move from so one table to another. And everybody has to put the stamp. Then only you will get your finer government order, your GO. Similarly, if somebody wants to go to Vrindavan, so many people have to sanction it. And even it says that the dust of Vrindavan also has to sign in that paper, sanction. And the moment all these people sanction, then somewhere we are sitting in a drawing room of our house, a desire may come in our heart, oh, let me go to Vrindavan. Oh, let me go to Vrindavan. And then you will go and buy a ticket. So even to get that desire and to get that ability to buy a ticket and go to Vrindavan will happen only when somebody has sufficiently pleased Krishna and got the sanction of all these people, the dust of Vrindavan and Govardhan and grass of Vrindavan and the cows of Vrindavan. If they have sanction, then we can go to Vrindavan. So here the dust of Vrindavan, the gopis are saying that dust looks so beautiful. See, Krishna is so beautiful. Nobody in this world can look beautiful in the evening. You know, even for us, materialistic people that we are, if we have to get a passport size photo of ours, we'll never go in the evening or after we come from office all tired. We'll get up in the morning, take fresh bath, and then we'll go for a photo, because we know when we get ready and we are all fresh, we look nice. But by the time it is evening, we'll look like putna. All that face will look so dull. But Krishna, he looks beautiful all the time, whether it's morning or midday or evening or when he comes from the forest, or when he comes after playing with the cowherd boys, in every situation. And he looks beautiful even when he is sweating. He looks beautiful even when he is in the war, when he is in the battlefield. Now, who looks beautiful in a battlefield, right? See, we see in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 1, Chapter 9, Sloka number 34, Bhishma, in his Bhishma Stuti, is explaining that, my dear Krishna, you look so beautiful even in the battlefield of Kurukshetra. See, what was happening in this battlefield? Krishna was driving the chariot out of affection for Arjun. And at that time, because there are so many horses and so many chariots in the battlefield, so much dust is coming on Krishna's face. He's a chariot driver. So here, Bhishma says that even though that thick dust was on your face and there was lots of sweat on your face, because you are driving the chariot, right? So the driver will be having all sweat, and because he's doing hard labor, but still your face looks so beautiful. You know, Bhishma says this very beautiful sloka. He says, Yudhitura garajo vidhumra vishvak kachalulita shramavari alang kritasye mama nishita sarir vibhidhyamana tvacha vilasat kavachestu Krishna atma. So beautiful. He says, Krishna, on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, your face looks so beautiful with that ash of the hoof of the horse. You know, the horse's hoof are making the dust fly up in the air, and that all dust settles on your face. And kwachalulita, your thick hair on your face, and shramavari alankritasya, the small drops of sweat on your face, and mama nishita share. What I was doing, I was trying to put those arrows on Arjun. But just to save Arjun, sometimes you used to take the chariot this side, that side, up, down. And because of that, those arrows used to come and pierce your heart. Of course, you had a kavacha, but because those arrows used to pierce your heart, small dots of blood used to come out from on your kavacha, you know, small droplets of blood. And believe me, Krishna, that particular face of yours is what I want to remember. Oh, you were looking so beautiful. Now imagine, who is going to look beautiful with sweat and blood? But Krishna looks beautiful in every situation. So Bhishma says, I want to meditate on that face of yours, Krishna. So here, the gopis are also saying the same thing. And here you see one very beautiful word the gopis have used. See, this whole gopi geet is so profound because the gopis have not simply used words because they are rhyming. They have used the words because there's a deep meaning in that. So here the gopis, they don't use the word pradarshana. They say darshana. There's a difference between pradarshan and darshan. Pradarshan is an exhibition. You see, and what happens in an exhibition? There are a lot of things on display and everybody watches the display. Everybody watches the thing with the same thing, with the same vision. But darshanam means where the object is same, but people look at it with different vision. That is why you see, when we take the darshan of the Lord, we say we are taking darshan. Darshan, because everybody will look at the Lord according to their own according to their own level in devotion, rather according to their relation with Krishna in this context. So here, when Krishna comes back in the evening with those cows, there are some gopis who are looking at Krishna with Vatsalya Rasa. There are some gopis who are looking at Krishna with Madhurya Rasa. There are some who are looking at Krishna with Sakya Rasa. So that is why here the gopis are saying darshan, when we take darshan of yours, because everybody according to their own status is looking at Krishna. And they said that such a beautiful face, manasi nas mare virayachasi, that beautiful face of your Krishna, it's just coming back in our memory again and again, again and again. Oh Krishna, please come back, please come back, you know, we want to see you. So this is they are explaining, see, more and more intimately the gopis are explaining about the beauty of the Lord's face. You see, even in Nama Ramayan, there is this one very beautiful sloka where it says that Aganita Gunagana Bhushita Rama Avanitanya Kamita Rama Raka Chandra Sama Anana Rama Pitruvakya Ashrita Kanana Rama 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 Jaya Raja Rama 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 Jaya Sita Ram. Very beautiful. It says Aganita Gunagana Bhushita Rama. The Lord has so many qualities. You can't even count. There is no maths to count the Lord's quality. And they say Raka Chandra Sama Anana Rama. The Lord's face is so beautiful, like a moon, like a moon. You know, you see, in Ramayana, it is said that Lord Rama was so beautiful looking that when the people used to look at Lord Ram, let's say if somebody looks at Lord Ram's eyes, then he's stuck there. He'll keep looking at Lord Ram's eyes only. And if at all somebody will ask him after some time, "Acha, how is Lord Ram's nose?" Then he'll say, "Noza, I didn't see because I was stuck with the eyes only. I cannot see. I am so mesmerized by his eyes that from his eyes I could not go down, I could not go up." If somebody used to look at Lord Ram's shoulder, then they are stuck at shoulder only. If you ask how is Lord Ram's face, they will say face. "Oh, I did not see the face because the shoulder is so beautiful. I was looking at the shoulder only." So anybody who looks at one particular part of the Lord's body, they're stuck there only. They can't see anything else. So beautiful the Lord is, because even if they force their eyes, can you just stop looking at his shoulders? Now let us look at his eyes. The senses will not accept. They will stand there only looking at his shoulder. So beautiful is the Lord's face, Lord's beauty, right? Lord's body is so beautiful. So here the gopis are saying, "Oh, we are mesmerized by it. We are again and again remembering you. We are not able to forget you." See, in Bhagavatam, there is this beautiful episode when Uddhava he goes to meet the gopis and counsel the gopis, you know, look, come on, don't cry so much. He's a supreme personality of Godhead. You can't expect that he's going to be with you all the time. He needs to do a lot of work. He has come here to deliver the sadhus, protect his devotees. He has to go around, right? So, and the gopis are crying, you know, but, you know, we are not able to forget him, and we are remembering his eyes, and we are remembering. Then Uddhava is saying, hold on, hold on. I'll give you some practical tip. You know what you do? You try to engage your mind. The problem is you're not engaging your mind. If you simply sit and keep thinking about Krishna, how can you, you know, why not you engage your mind? Keep your mind busy. So keep your mind in some kind of an activity, you know, then slowly your pain will become little less. Now Uddhava thinks, I gave such a nice practical tip. But the gopis are laughing. They said, Uddhav, we thought that you are very intelligent. You are from a city. You are a disciple of Brihaspati. We thought you were very intelligent. But you are speaking like a foolish person. And Uddhav is shocked. Why are they telling me foolish? And then the gopis say, Uddhav, let us inform you something. We are simple village girls. And we have only one mind. And that mind Krishna has stolen and taken away with him to Mathura. Now, we don't know, maybe the city people, they may be having many minds. So one mind they can put in work, one mind they can put in eating, one mind in sleeping, one mind in thinking about Krishna. Maybe they can divide like that. But you know, villagers, we have only one mind. And that mind Krishna stole and took away. So now we don't know what we should do. So they say in Vrajabhasha very beautifully, they say, Odhav man na bhaye das bees. Oh, mind are not 10, 20, 30 in quantity. It's only one. And that one mind Krishna has taken away. So we don't even have our mind with us that we will engage it in some activity. So here the gopis are saying, what should we do? We're just remembering you again and again. Oh Krishna, please come back. Please come back. We'll go to the next sloka. Pranata kamadam padmajachitam dharani mandanam dheyamapadi charana pankajam santamam chate ramananastane alpayadihan. So here the gopis are saying, pranata kamadam. Oh Krishna, when somebody bows down to you, when somebody surrenders to you, you know what you do with them? You give them kama dam. You give them kama. Oh, we'll be surprised. Krishna gives them kama. We thought Krishna takes away kama, is it not? No, what the gopis are talking here is, you give them spiritual desire. You give them spiritual desire and you take away their material desire. To whom do you do that? To the ones who surrender to you. To the ones who bow down to you. So here the gopis are saying, pranata kamadam padma jarchitam. Kamadam, you will give them spiritual desires and you will take away the material desires. See, now the problem is, all of us, it is said that on an average, a normal human being, he gets 32,000 desires, or rather 32,000 thoughts in his mind on any given day. Now out of these 32,000 thoughts, we may have this one thought, oh, I want to become a devotee of Krishna. But the problem is, this is only one thought. And these 31,999 thoughts, they just defeat this one thought of yours. And this one thought goes down somewhere in the drain. So now we need help, because this thought is alone and there are so many other materialistic thoughts which are more in number. So here, somebody who bows down to Krishna, what Krishna does is, Krishna gives strength to that one small thought. And then one small thought will become a bigger thought and it will crush all the other 31,999 thoughts. So to hear what the gopis are saying. Pranata kamadam, you will give spiritual desire with which the devotees can kill their material desires, and this is done for those who bow down to Krishna. Pranata kamadam, padmajarchitam. Here the gopis are saying, and you know what? Not only do the normal people surrender to you, even Padmajarchita. Padmaja means the one who is born out of a lotus. Who is born out of a lotus? Brahma. So they are saying even Padmajarchitam, the one who is born out of lotus, Brahma, also surrenders to you. So here the gopi is, see, this gopi geet is not only a song of suppression, it is also gopi geeta, because gopis are giving us such deep knowledge. Here the gopis are trying to say that, you know, we should approach Krishna directly. Now how they are saying this, see, because we approach the devatas the moment we are in problem. Oh Indra, give rain, or Shiva, please help us, or Kuvera, so Shiva, Ganesh, whatever. So here we go to the devatas, but when the devatas are in trouble, they go to Brahma, and when Brahma is in trouble, he goes to Krishna. So here the gopis are saying, why not approach directly Krishna? So here the gopis are clarifying that even those whom we think apparently they may give us shelter are actually taking shelter from you, Krishna. Even Padmaja, the Charchita, Brahma, who is approached by the devatas, are also taking shelter of you. So here the gopis are indirectly trying to tell us that why not approach Krishna directly? Why indirectly? So here he says, Pranata Kamadam Padmajarchitam Dharini Mandanam Dheyamapadi. Says that your lotus feet, Krishna, are so powerful. They are like the ornaments for Dharti Mata, right? Like the women, they decorate themselves, right, with some kind of an ornament, maybe some earrings, maybe some necklace, and then they look beautiful. So he says that Dharani looks beautiful because your lotus feet are on her. See, in Vrindavan, everywhere there were Krishna's lotus feet. Yesterday we were discussing that the cows and all, they never used to stamp on Krishna's lotus feet. When the Kaliya Daman Leela happened and Krishna was in the Yamuna water with Kaliya, the Vrajavasis, they did not have to ask anybody, "Acha, where did Krishna go today for grazing? Did he go to Bahulavan or did he go to Matavan or Lohavan?" They didn't have to ask that, because they will simply follow the footprints of Krishna's lotus feet. And for them, that is only GPS. They will simply follow, because in Vrindavan, nobody will stamp over Krishna's feet. Even the cows will also not stamp over Krishna's feet. Wherever his feet are, they will go away from other side. So easily the Vrajavasis followed those lotus feet, and somehow they reached the Yamuna where Krishna was fighting with the Kaliya. So here the gopis are saying, Dharani, even the earth is so happy because she has your lotus feet on her. You see, there is this very beautiful conversation between Dharma and Dharini, between the Mother Earth and Dharma, where the Mother Earth is telling to Dharma, I don't want to stay here. I want to go back, because Krishna has left. You know, when Krishna left this planet and he went back to his Nija Dham, even the rivers were crying. They went and fold hand to Krishna. Krishna, we want to come back with you. We can't stay in your separation. So here the Dharini Mata is also saying that I cannot stay in separation of Krishna. And here Mother Earth is expressing her sorrow. She says that, see, if I had no contact with Krishna, then no problem. I never met him, I never saw him, then no problem. But I had so close contact with him. He was on me all the time, touching me with his lotus feet. And now suddenly if he goes away, it's very difficult. Because I once got the taste of being in touch with him. So she's expressing that I can't live without his touch. So here saying that, Dharini Mandanam, you are the ornament for earth. Oh Krishna, your lotus feet is not only the ornament for earth, it is also the ornament for us. We want to place your lotus feet on our chest. It is also an ornament for our bodies, your lotus feet. Then he says, Dheyamapadi, Krishna, who approaches your lotus feet, all their desires are fulfilled. And when are we supposed to approach the lotus feet of Krishna? Apadi, apada. If somebody is in trouble and if they are intelligent enough, they will approach Krishna, is what the gopis are saying. See, the problem is, you see, sometimes, you know, you ask somebody, Prabhu, why didn't you come for the Friday program? No, Prabhu, actually, you know, this was the problem, that was the problem, this happened, that happened. Now, the gopis are saying that whenever the problem happens, you're all the more supposed to surrender to Krishna. What we think is, when all the problems are sorted out, then I'm retired, nothing to do, definitely I'll dedicate to Krishna. But you know, now this is a problem, that is a problem. But gopis are saying, those who are intelligent, when there is a problem, they will approach Krishna. You see, if some doctor asks, you know, why didn't you come to me? Oh, no, actually I had fever, na, that's why I didn't come. I thought once the fever is reduced, then I'll come. That will be so foolish. You are supposed to go to the doctor when you have fever. He will give you medicine. You don't have to cure your fever and then go and meet doctor. So here they're saying that when somebody is in apada, when somebody is in trouble, they're all the more supposed to approach Krishna. They're all the more supposed to surrender to Krishna. And here the gopis are saying, and those who surrender to your lotus feet, their desire is fulfilled. Oh Krishna, we are also suffering. We are also suffering. And our suffering can be reduced only if you give your lotus feet to us. So here they are telling about the different qualities of Krishna's lotus feet. Because here they said first point they said, Kamadam. If they surrender to your lotus feet, their desires are fulfilled. That means spiritual desires are increased, material desires are decreased. Then they said that Dharani Mandanam, your lotus feet are like ornaments. Then the third point they said, Dheyamapadi, your lotus feet are the only shelter for those who are in trouble. So like that, they're talking about different qualities of Krishna's lotus feet. And then they say, Charana Pankajam Santamam Chate. Another quality of your lotus feet is Krishna. It gives satisfaction. Santamam. It gives satisfaction. Those who surrender to your lotus feet, they get satisfaction. Then they say, Ramana Nastane Arpayadihan. Krishna, please give those two lotus feet on our chest and relieve us from this suffering. Very, 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 very deep thing gopis are talking about here. And it is such a beautiful take-home lesson for us that whenever we are in trouble, we have to approach Krishna. We have to approach Krishna. You know, there is a very beautiful saying in English. We should not go and tell Krishna, oh my Lord, my problem is so big, you know, this is a problem, that is a problem, this is... What you're supposed to do is, you're supposed to tell the problem, look, my Lord is very big, you are nothing, my Lord can sort out anything. So, you should not tell Krishna how big is your problem, you should tell the problem how big is my Lord. My Lord can sort out any problem. Every problem in front of the Lord is very small. So the gopis are saying one should approach Krishna. Now, a very important question may arise here. Mataji, many a times we see that the devotees are approaching Krishna when they are in problem. But sometimes we see that Krishna is not helping. They are still in the same problem. And there is no help rendered from Krishna's side. But here the gopikas are saying, your lotus feet which are worshipped by Lord Brahma fulfill the desire of those who bow down. So what about this statement? Why are people who are bowing down to Krishna not getting immediate relief? Now the very important point to understand here is, sometimes Krishna gives us relief from the problem, but sometimes Krishna gives us relief amidst the problem. I'll repeat again. Sometimes Krishna gives us relief from the problem. Sometimes Krishna gives us relief amidst the problem. Within the problem, He'll give us relief. That means He will give us the strength to face the problem. It's not that always the solution is that He will sort out your problem and now you are happy. No. Sometimes the problem cannot be sorted out. But Krishna will give you strength to face that problem. See, I'll give you one very beautiful example. I think it was 2 years back, I was in Pune. We were attending this GBC college. And along with us, there were many Prabhupada disciples also who were doing this zonal secretary course. Now, one very nice, very sweet Prabhupada disciple from New Vrindavan, His Grace Gaura Shakti Prabhu, was also with us in that college. And one morning he gave this Bhagavatam class. It was so beautiful. One particular example that he gave was so heart-touching. And listen carefully, because that will, if you just remember this example, it will always help you, no matter what situation you are put in. So Gaura Shakti Prabhu, he was sharing with us. He said, you know, when I was a new devotee, new brahmachari, young brahmachari, we used to enjoy the Sunday feast. You know, a Sunday feast in ISKCON, we all know, is grand. So many varieties. So he said, we used to love the Sunday feast. But the problem is, Monday the food used to be again same, rice, dal, sabji, simple food. So Sunday we used to be very happy, but Monday food was simple, but we used to still be happy because just last night we ate, na? So that memory will be there. So Monday food somehow we'll manage. Tuesday it will become little difficult because this rice, dal, sabji. Wednesday it will be like a terrible, my God, we can't eat this rice, dal, sabji. We are having that memory of that Sunday feast, so many varieties. By Thursday, tears will come down. Oh, I don't want to eat this food. It is so hopeless. When will Sunday come? And by Friday, don't ask us. We are waiting. By Saturday, we are excited. Okay, just one more day and now Sunday will come. So this is a regular routine. So Gaura Shakti Prabhu said, you know, once I read in Bhagavatam that Krishna can sort out all our problems. So we were young brahmacharis. We thought this is big problem for us because we want to eat good prasadam. So he said, I sincerely stood in front of the deities and I requested Krishna, Krishna, please sort out this problem about our food. So he said, because I had so much faith and I was a young boy, so I thought maybe Krishna will show some miracle. So after Sunday, when Monday morning came, I took my plate, I went inside the dining hall and I thought maybe miraculously there will be a lot of varieties because I prayed to Krishna. And I saw nothing, same rice, same dal and same sabji was there. Then I thought, no problem, maybe Tuesday, Krishna will definitely show some miracle. So Tuesday I went running, again same rice, same dal, same sabji. Then I thought, all right, sometime Krishna takes time, that's all right. And Wednesday I went with same excitement, but same rice, same dal, same sabji. On Thursday also when I went, I ate very happily and came out very happily from the dining hall. So we all asked, oh, so Thursday they changed the menu? He said, no, they did not change the menu. I got used to that rice, dal, sabji. Because I'm eating every day, na? I got used to. So now what happened? He made a very beautiful point. He said, Krishna did not change the menu, but Krishna made me used to that menu. Now I was not feeling so bad. I became used to it. That's all right. I became habituated to it. And then he made this very beautiful point. He said, it's not that every time Krishna will sort out our problem. Sometimes he'll just give us strength. Sometimes he will just give us strength to face that problem. And I thought, that was so deep realization, which we can all keep in our hearts. It's not that we should always expect Krishna to sort out our problem, but we can pray Krishna, that Krishna, just be there, just hold my hand, just be there and give me strength to face this problem. So here, the gopis are giving this very beautiful example that Krishna, those who are intelligent, they approach you when they are in problem. Now we'll go to the next sloka. Of course, I would have liked to elaborate on this because as devotees, this is a very important point. See, for us, what may take us away from Krishna is problems. That's all. Otherwise, you know, we will never break gross rules and regulations because we are reading scriptures enough, right? We will not start eating meat, or we will not do anything grossly wrong. But what may happen with us is sometimes we may just get into this whole net of problems that we face because of our previous karma, which may take us away from Krishna. So, and then we may start having this exaggerated hope that Krishna has to sort out my every problem because I'm a 16 rounder. Krishna has to sort out my every problem because I'm preaching about him, because I'm his devotee. So, but when we read these and, you know, when we try to read in between lines of what these beautiful instructions given by gopis, we understand that, no, it's not like that. It's not like that, you know. It's just that Krishna has a different solution. See, sometimes we think we are very intelligent. We tell the problem to Krishna and we also tell the solution to Krishna. Krishna, this is a problem and this is a solution, and that does not work for Krishna. Krishna will say that you are telling your problem, that's very nice, but solution I will give according to my intelligence, because I'm more intelligent than you are. So as devotees, we need to have that faith on Krishna. And at any point of time, no matter what situation comes, we are not supposed to leave the shelter of Krishna. That is very important. The bigger problem in our life will be that when we lose faith and start taking shelter of others. Sometimes I've seen in cases of some devotees, they start taking shelter of some demigods when they're in a lot of problems. So that shouldn't happen. And that is a big risk. So no matter what situation is, we shouldn't give up taking shelter of Krishna. And that will be a bigger problem if we forget Krishna. See, if you see in Ramayana, when Hanuman, he goes to Ashok Vatika, and there he is speaking with Sita Mata, and he's just telling Mata, I'm so sad, you know, seeing you like this, and here is the Lord Ram's mudrika, the finger ring of Lord Ram, and now I have to go back and inform Lord Ram about your situation. So Hanuman says, Mother, what message should I give to Ram? Because he'll ask me, how is Mother Sita? So I have to inform him. So what should I tell Mother to Lord Ram? So Sita says, tell Ram, I'm all right. So Hanuman is like, what? Because, you know, the way the situation she is in. And then Sita Mata says this very beautiful line. She says, Suno Hanumanta Vipati Prabhu Soi Jabatava Sumirana Bhajana Na Hoi. Says that, Hanuman, you know what it means by Vipati? Do you know what it means by trouble? Trouble is when one forgets the bhajan and sumiran of Lord Ram, then that is the actual vipatti in somebody's life. This is not vipatti. This temporary situation that I have been put in, this is not trouble. Why this is not trouble? Because I have not forgotten Lord Ram even for a second. I'm all the time in his constant remembrance. So if we are in constant remembrance of Lord, then we are not in trouble. The actual trouble is if we forget Krishna, then we are in real trouble. So as devotees, no matter what situation we are put in this material world, if somehow or the other we can just remember Krishna and we can stick to Krishna, then we are not in trouble. We will be protected by Krishna. So this is very, 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 very a beautiful point here, that no matter what situation we are in, we should never leave the shelter of Lord Krishna's lotus feet. Now we'll go to the next sloka. Here we are. Suratavardhanam shokanashanam svaritavenuna shushtachumbitam itararagave smaranam nirnam vitaravirana te dharamritam. So here the gopis are saying, O Krishna, kindly distribute the nectar of your lips. Please give us your adharam. That nectar is thoroughly relished by your flute and makes people forget any other attachment. This is a very, very beautiful sloka. Here the gopis are making a very important point. The gopis say, Krishna, we are all suffering from a disease. Now the medicine for this disease is द फ्लूट दैट यू वेरी काइंडली प्ले by placing your lotus like lips, your adharam on that flute, and that sound vibration which comes cures us of all our diseases, and it increases our attachment to you to such an extent that we forget our other attachments. Here it says itara raga vismaran, we will forget. See why they are mentioning, because Krishna may say, oh, I am very kindly, you know, offering my my flute to the people suffering in this material world, but people are not getting attached to me. So gopis are saying that they will get attached. See, I'll tell you this very exactly one very beautiful point he makes here. He says that if somebody hear your flute, only then they can give up the attachment to other things. Because first of all, attachment to you should increase. And how to increase the attachment to you? By hearing you. Now, the gopis, they are requesting this because they want that Krishna should come back and Krishna should play the flute so that they can hear Krishna's flute and they can relish. But now, we as devotees may think that gopis have that opportunity to hear Krishna's flute, but what about us? We don't have chance to hear Krishna's flute. But the Vaishnava Acharyas say that the Krishna's flute of Dwapar Yuga has again reborn as Mridanga in Kali Yuga. So here we are hearing Krishna's flute when we do Harinama Sankirtana. When we chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. When we chant this Maha Mantra, when we play this Mridanga, then we are also hearing Krishna's flute. And then what happens when we hear this Harinam Sankirtan, when we hear this Krishna's flute? This will happen. Itara Raga Vismarana. The other material attachments we will be able to give up easily. See, that is why we see in the devotee's life, you know, so many of them, they share, Hare, I got so much attracted by the kirtan. Somebody will say, I got so much attracted by Krishna Prasadam. Somebody will say, I got so much attracted by Prabhupada books. Somebody will say, I got so much attracted by this katha. Now what happens? All these they will increase our attachment to Krishna. And the moment attachment to Krishna is increased, then attachment to other things automatically decrease. So here the gopis are saying, that is why we are requesting you, O Surata Vardhana Shokanashanam, all our material suffering or all our suffering will go away, Krishna, if we can hear your flute. Please come back so that we can hear the beautiful flute of yours. See, I remember this very beautiful story. It's very interesting. You know, one of my Siksha Gurus, he's Prabhupada disciple. He used to distribute books in Bangalore. So once he was telling us this very beautiful incident. He was telling that in my younger days, when I used to go for book distribution, it so happened once that I went to an office and I was requesting that officer that, sir, why can't you take one book? This is, you know, this is marathon month and please see our books. So that officer said, I'm not interested, please go. So I said, can you just allow me 1 minute? So my Siksha Guru, he was carrying these books in his bag. So he just took out those books and he says, allow me 2 minutes, I'll just show you. If you are interested, you take, otherwise not required. So he started putting those books on the table. And the moment he was putting the books on the table, this officer, he shouted, please don't do that, remove these books from here. Now this devotee, he said, look sir, this is not a time bomb, this is just books, it's not going to blast or something, I just want to keep in your table, I'll show you. So then this officer, he made a very beautiful point. He said, can you see that table and chair next to me? He said, yeah, I can see. And can you see that chair is empty? He said, yeah, I can see. Then he said, let me tell you what happened. Last year, one of your devotees came with the same ISKCON books. And my colleague who was sitting next to me had purchased those books and he had read those books and he became a devotee. And it so happened now that he left this job And now, just like what you are doing, he is also going from office to office and selling books. So, let me tell you, I'm very attached to my wife and children. I'm very attached to my job. I don't want to give up my job. So kindly don't keep these books on my table. They're very dangerous. This empty chair next to me gives me a lot of inspiration never to touch ISKCON books. Because he was such a respected officer, and now I see he has shaven his head and is going from door to door like a beggar selling books, and I don't want to become like him. So don't you even show me these books. So I thought this was such a funny pastime, that how the books containing Krishna's katha are so powerful. They can change anybody, right? So that's why the gopis are saying the same thing here, that your flute, the sound vibration of your flute is so powerful. Itara raga, all the other attachments will very easily go away, right? That is why you see Rupa Goswami, he sings this very beautiful song. He says, Bandhu sange jadi tava ranga parihas. It's in Bengali, I'll explain. Bandhu sange jadi tava ranga parihas. Thake abhilash, thake abhilash. Tabe mora kotha rakho, jeyo nako, jeyo nako. Tabe mora kotha rakho, jeyo nako, jeyo nako. Mathurae kesi tirthe, ghate rasakash. Bandhu sange jadi tava, ranga parihas. Rupa Goswami is saying, if you have attachment towards your relatives and friends and your family members, your husband and wife and children, then tabe mora kotha rakho. Then kindly listen. I'm giving one very important information. Jeyo nako, jeyo nako. Don't go, don't go. Where you should not go? You should not go to Kesi Ghat in the moonlit night, because Krishna is there under the Vamsi Vat playing his beautiful flute. And the moment you see this black, bluish boy on the moonlit night at the Kesi Ghat, you will lose all attachments to your wife and children, and you will become a madman behind this boy. So I'm warning you, Bandhu Sange Jaditava, if you have little affection for your family members, don't go to this boy. Don't hear about him. Don't go to him. It's a way of saying that how attractive Krishna is. So here, that's what the gopis are saying, that once if somebody comes in touch with you, once if somebody hears you, once if somebody hears your beautiful flute, Krishna, this is a natural product. Itara raga vismarana. They will lose all attachment. And what is the proof? We are the proof. Look at us, what happened to us. We are respectable ladies from respectable families, and look what we are now in the middle of the night in this dark, dense forest. We are searching for you. We have become mad. We become crazy. We have lost all intelligence. See what we are doing. So anybody who hears you, definitely this is what is going to happen to them. Their attachment for you will increase, and their detachment for material objects will happen. Their attachment will increase towards you. This is what they are saying. Well, we are on the sloka number 14, and we need to complete. Yeah, we'll try to go as fast as possible. And without much stories, we'll try to finish it quickly. We'll go to the next sloka. Atatiyad bhavan anikananam trutiyugayate twamapashyatam kutilakuntalam shrimukham chate jada udikshata pakshmakridrisham. This is also very important sloka, because Srila Prabhupada, along with the Tavakathamritam sloka, he used to regularly quote this sloka. So here in herein the gopis are saying, because see, Krishna, he may argue with the gopis that you are talking as if you haven't seen me for so many yugas or something like that. I was here just a few moments ago. So why so much talking as if you didn't see me for so many years? Is, you know, what is the problem? So here the gopis are explaining what is the problem. Why are we singing this? So the gopis say, oh, you may think, you know, that I was just here a couple of moments ago. But for us, every moment without you is like a yuga. It's like many, many years. So here the gopis are saying that even a fraction of a second for us is very big. So here the gopis are saying, if we don't see you, if you see deeply, it's not even a second. Here in the translation it says tiny fraction of a second. That means in the commentary the acharyas say, gopis are not saying that, oh Krishna, if we don't see you for a minute, they are saying if we don't see you for a second, and in that second also, if you cut 1 second into 1,700 pieces, and out of that if you take one piece, that means 1 by 1,000. So here the gopis are saying that even for a fraction of a second, if we don't see you, then we feel as if we haven't seen you for many, many yugas. So here the gopis are expressing their problem. You know what is our problem? First of all, we fight with the sun. When is the sun going to set? When are you going to come and we'll see your beautiful face in the evening? And when you actually walk in, then your hair disturbs, because your hair is very thick and it just covers your face. And then we wait for the wind to blow your hair so that we can see your beautiful face. And when the hair blows and now we are ready to see your face, at that time tears start flowing from our eyes. And because tears are flowing from our eyes, we can't see you, my Lord. And now when we somehow or the other control our tears, please don't flow, we want to see Krishna, then this foolish person makes problem for us. Who is that foolish person? That Jada, this Brahma. Because he made this eyes which keeps on blinking. So now even though we have control over tears, now these eyelids are blinking. So again we are not able to see you. So here the gopis are angry on Brahma. They call him Murkha. They call him Jada. He's so foolish. They are trying to say that if we were creators, we would never create such kind of eyes which keeps on blinking. What is the use of blinking? Why do they have to blink? Because when they blink, then we can't see Krishna. So the gopis are criticizing the creator. So they say, Krishna, we are already in trouble. Sometimes the tears disturb, sometimes these eyelids disturb, and we cannot see your beautiful face. Oh Krishna, please come back. For us, it is like a millennium. We haven't seen you. Right? Oh, please come back, Krishna. And that's what the gopis are saying. Jada Udikshata, this foolish creator has made our eyelids in such a way that they blink and they disturb the beautiful vision of seeing your beautiful face. We'll go to the next sloka. Pati Sutanvaya Bhatrubandhavan Ativa langhyate achuta gata gati vidastavo gita mohita kitava yoshita kastaje nishi. So here the gopis are saying, we have given up everything, my Lord. We gave up our husband, our children, our families, pati, sutanvaya, everything. And we just came like mad people, to see you just because you called us. Because now Krishna may say, why are you giving all this lecture to me? Did I call you? Did I come to your house and say, come, can you come to the forest now? I didn't call you. Who asked you to come? So here the gopis are clarifying. You asked us to come because you played the flute. And we know that you play this flute for us, for calling us. And because you played the flute, we left everybody. And we just came to you, my Lord. And now you are rejecting us. Is this fair, what you are doing with us? See, when Krishna used to play the flute, every rhythm or every tune was for different purpose. When he plays the fifth tune from his flute, it is for calling the gopis. When he plays the eighth tune, it's for calling Radharani. Just like we have cell phone tunes. For different callers, we have different tunes. So we know, okay, this person is calling or that person is calling. So Krishna also had that arrangement. When he plays tune number 3, then the moon will stop. When he plays the tune number 2, Yamuna will forget the course of her direction. When he plays a tune number 1, Brahma will forget creation. When he plays the tune number 4, all the animals will stop there. They will be freezed. When he plays tune number 6, then all the mountains will start melting, or rather all the seasons will appear at a time. When he plays tune number 7, the mountains will melt. So like that, for everybody there is a tune. So tune number 5 is for gopis. So gopis said, you played the tune, my Lord. That is why we came. We left everybody. Just because you called, we came. And now you are rejecting us. So this is what the gopis are doing here. It's the highest, you know. Who can give up families? Today we are all devotees, but how many can give up their families? What the gopis are doing is the highest surrender. They have given up everything. See, our gurus are not even asking us. Our Guru Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada, is not even asking us that you leave your family and come. They're asking, come, bring your family and come into Krishna consciousness. Still it is becoming so difficult for us. Even bringing the family, forget about leaving the family and coming into Krishna consciousness. But here you see the gopis have done such a great sacrifice. They left their families for Krishna. So how great devotees they are. That's why they are called Bhakti Acharyas. So they're saying, Krishna, please come back. Don't do this. You are Achyuta. Achyuta means one who is infallible. You're not supposed to waver in your qualities. You don't change your qualities according to situation. You're always same. And you're supposed to be kind-hearted. Why are you doing that, Krishna? Please come back. And here one very important point they say is, Krishna, your flute is very loud. Udgita. This is a very important point. See, you never say something, like let's say if somebody asks you, Prabhuji, how was the kirtan yesterday evening in the program? You will say, kirtan was very sweet. But you will not say that kirtan was very loud. You will say kirtan was sweet. But here the gopis are not saying that your venu is sweet. The gopis are saying that your flute is loud. So what they are trying to tell Krishna is that, Krishna, your flute is so loud into our ears that we are not able to hear anything but your flute. And that is why we came running to you. See, when we are attached to somebody, then anything to do with that person will attract us. See, like for example, the parents, when they are so attached to the children, you know, sometimes especially mothers, even if they are cooking and 2-3 rooms away, the child is sleeping in the bedroom. And if the little noise the child will make, and here the mother is in cooking and she's putting a chance and the pressure cooker is ringing, still she will be able to hear the voice of the child. Why? Because she's so attached to the child. Even if the child is very slowly saying, Mama, still the mother knows that my child is calling me because she's attached. So gopis are saying that you must have played the flute somewhere in the forest and we are here in our houses. But we are attached to you, Krishna. That is why your flute is like very loud for us. And we can hear nothing but your flute. When your flute is going on, we forget what our husband is talking, what is happening in the kitchen, everything we forget. So Krishna, we just came to you with so much love and affection. Please don't reject us. Please don't reject us. So he said that, you know, the flute noise was very, very loud, and that's why we came here. And then one very, very important point the gopis say that with your flute, which is so loud, you have mohita, you have attracted us. So our situation is like that of the birds. You know, sometimes the hunter, he will put a net, he will put some grains, and when the bird come, the hunter will capture those bird in the net and walk away. So the gopis said, you did the same thing with us. You just played your flute and like innocent birds, we came off in your net. And the moment we came, यू जस्ट हैप्पीली सिंपली स्टोलन अवर हार्ट्स एंड वॉकड अवे हैप्पीली वॉकड अवे विथ अवर हार्ट. डोंट डू दैट. डोंट बी सो क्रूअल कृष्णा. प्लीज कम बैक. प्लीज कम बैक. विल गो टू द नेक्स्ट श्लोका. रहसि संविदां हृच्छयोदयं प्रहसिताननां प्रेमवीक्षणं बृहदुराश्रियो वीक्षधामते मुहूर्ति स्पृहा मुह्यते मना. सो नाउ दे आर सेइंग दैट वी आर रिमेंबरिंग योर स्माइलिंग फेस. वी आर रिमेंबरिंग योर ग्लांस. वी आर रिमेंबरिंग डिफरेंट लिम्स ऑफ योर बॉडी. दे आर सेइंग दैट माय डियर लॉर्ड, if you would have never given us time previously, so much personal time, then we would have not got attached to you. Sometimes, you know, some very important people, some VIPs, if they give us lot of personal association and time, then we become so overwhelmed. We get so attached because Krishna is a VVIP. So he said, from beginning, if you would not have given us time, it was okay. But because you gave us time, you spent time with us, and now if you go away, then we are suffering. Oh Krishna, so many confidential things you shared with us. Now don't go away like that. Please come back. And then they make a very nice point here. They say that this hankering to see you again is a very strong hankering. Don't think it's very a very simple desire. See, sometimes, you know, in our lives also, we have two kinds of desire. Some desires are small desires. They come and they go away. Even if they are not fulfilled, they will disturb us for some time and then it will go away. But some desires are very strong. They just don't leave us. We have to somehow fulfill them. They are very tivra, very strong. So the gopis are saying, our desire to see you is also very strong. Don't think, you know, oh, these girls, they will cry for some time. Afterwards, they will go home. Nothing to worry. Don't think like that. We will not go home. We'll sit here only. We'll keep crying until you come. Because this desire in our heart is very strong. We want to see you, Krishna. Please come back. So, here the you know, in Gopal Champu, there is one very beautiful point where the yogis say that Krishna's sidelong glance is so beautiful. It is like the end of all shastras. After that, there is nothing to be read in the scriptures. But here the gopis also talk about the loving glances of Krishna, but they say it is not end of the shastras, it is end of the shastra. Shastra means, you know, knife or dagger. What is there at the end of a knife? It's very sharp. If it goes in your stomach, blood will come out. So the gopis are saying that your loving glances are sharp like a shastra. The moment somebody sees your loving glance, oh, you kill them. You kill them. And after that, if they can't see you, they will die. So, oh Krishna, don't kill us. Please come back, is what the gopis are saying. Go to the next sloka. Vrajavanakasham vyaktirangate vrijahantriyalam विश्वमंगलम् त्यजामनाक्षनास् त्वास्पृहात्मनम् स्वजनहृद्रुजाम् यानिशूदनम्. सो हियर दे आर सेइंग दैट ओ कृष्णा, यू नो, your auspicious appearance will vanquish all the distress of those who are living in the forest of Vraja. They are saying, Krishna, you are so kind. You actually go into the forest because you want to show yourself to every jiva. You want to be nice to those creepers and leaves and monkeys and earthworms and insects and animals. You want to give your beautiful darshan to everybody and you want to vanquish their distress. That is why you enter inside the forest. And our minds are also longing to look at you. When you have such a beautiful heart that you want to vanquish the distress of everybody, then Krishna, why don't you want to vanquish our distress? Please vanquish our distress. Please appear in front of us. And then the gopis say, look Krishna, we don't want anything else. Our only medicine is that we want to see you. We want to look at you. I thought this is also a very important point. See, sometimes you see mothers, you know, when they want to go for a party or they want to go for a program, they will bribe the child. They'll give some chocolate, they'll give some toy. So the child will start playing with the toy and chocolate and they'll forget. And the mother will go for the party. But some children, they're very intelligent. Even if mother gives chocolate or mother gives some car, the child will say, no, mother, I want you only. Then the mother will say, all right, then get ready. I'll take you with me for the party. Similarly, as devotees, we have to be very careful. When we pray to Krishna, Krishna is very smart. He'll start giving you material things. He'll give you some nice job, money, nice situation, nice circumstances. He'll start giving you all toys, one after another. One car, bigger car, more money, more Aishwarya. And he'll try to divert you. So, and if we start playing with it, then slowly Krishna will escape. But if we are intelligent, and we say, hey Krishna, don't give me all this, okay? This property, money, this is not going to drive away my attention from you. Oh Krishna, I want you. I want only you. Then Krishna will say, okay, all right then, come, hold my hand. Let's go back to Goloka Vrindavan. This is what Krishna will do. So we have to be so careful as devotees. We shouldn't get melted by Krishna's bribes. He will start giving all material opulences. So we should be very, very careful. So gopis are saying, look, we don't want anything but you, only you, Krishna. So don't try to bribe us, okay? Please come, and only you are our only medicine which can drive away our distress. Coming to the last and the final sloka of Gopi Geet. Yatte sujata charanamburaham staneshu bhitasane priyadadimahi karakasheshu तेनातविम अतसितद्यथतेन किं स्वात् कूरापदि विभ्रमति धीर्भवदायुषं नाम. Now the gopis are saying, oh dear beloved Lord, your lotus feet are so soft, you will get hurt if you move around here and there. Just come back, enough of the play, enough of it. Just come and give us your feet. We are in anxiety, you will be wounded somewhere. Okay, forget about what all, you know, we showed you pride, this happened, that happened. Okay, forget. We won't do any more Ninda Stuti also, we won't criticize. Forget about everything, we'll be your obedient servant. But as of now, our main worry is, you will get hurt, Baba, in your leg, somewhere you will get hurt and you will wound yourself. Because in this forest, there are lots of pebbles here and there. So just come back. We have to put your feet on our chest. We cannot allow your feet to get hurt. Oh Krishna, please come back. And saying this, the last sloka of Gopi Geet, the gopis start crying loudly. They are crying, crying. And then what happens? Sukhdev Goswami says in the next chapter. Shri Sukha Uvacha Iti Gopya Pragayantya Pralapantyascha Chetradha Rurudasu Swaram Rajan Krishna Darshana Lalasa. Oh, the gopis are crying. And you see here, very nice one point the Sukhdev Goswami is mentioning. Loudly they are crying. It's not that a little bit they're crying. They're crying loudly. You know, like small children, how they cry, you know, bah, you know, like making a big noise, the gopis are crying. Why they're crying? Krishna darshana lalasa. They just want to see Krishna. And then in the text too, Sukhdev Goswami says, Tasham avira bhuchauri smaya smaya mana mukhambuja pitambara dhara shragvi shakshad manmata manmata. When the gopis start crying When the gopis start crying like this loudly, what happens? Sukadev Goswami says, finally Krishna comes back. And when he comes back, he's laughing because all the time he's been hearing all these gopis crying and all these different things that gopis are telling him. So here Krishna comes with a smile, very mischievous, naughty smile. He just comes out from where he was hiding behind the bushes. He just comes out. And then what is he doing? He has a Vaijayanti mala, a garland, and he's wearing his yellow garments. And he and Sukadev Goswami says, he's appearing like Manmatha Manmatha. So beautiful, that even forget about ordinary people, even Manmatha, the Cupid will also fall unconscious if he sees Krishna's face. So beautiful Krishna is looking. So finally Krishna comes back, and when the gopis see that dear most Krishna is back, they are so happy. Oh, they are full of affection. Their life has come back. It's as if their nostrils are now full of air. They're able to breathe again. And of course, and then Sukadev Goswami goes on explaining how Krishna consoles them, and then they all become happy and they all again reunite and they again have the rasa dance. So here, with this, we end the gopi geet of how the gopis, by their sincere prayers and by steady prayers, not only sincere, they didn't give it up, they could finally get Krishna. So as devotees, it's such an important lesson for us. If we don't give up this process, even if Krishna appears, doesn't appear, responds, doesn't respond, and we just keep sincerely praying to him and we don't lose hope, under the constant shelter of our guru and sadhu and shastra, and we steadily practice our sadhana and keep doing devotional service, definitely one fine day Krishna will come out from those bushes where he's hiding with his mischievous naughty smile, and he will come and give himself to us, and he'll hug us. So we are all waiting for that day, and we need to keep patience like the gopis kept patience. And that is possible when we are in association of devotees, because gopis also, they were in association of other gopis, and that is why they were encouraging and supporting each other, that let's wait, Krishna will come. So similarly, we also have to be in constant association of devotees who will encourage us and guide us, that keep patience, one day we will be successful on our journey home, back home, back to Godhead. So thank you so much. Gopi Geet ki jai, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Sab Krishna, Krishna, Krishna.